This is Fresh Air. I'm Terry Gross. We continue our series, Songs from Hollywood and Broadway, with a 1985 interview with the late lyricist Sammy Cahn. He died in 93 at the age of 79. Sammy Cahn is one of America's most celebrated popular song lyricists, and you probably know all the words to a dozen or two of some of the hundreds of songs that he's written. With composer Saul Chaplin, he wrote Until the Real Thing Comes Along, Rhythm in My nursery Rhymes, Shoeshine Boy, and the popular version of Bamia Bistushane, which they adapted from the Yiddish stage. With Julie Stein, Cahn wrote I Fall in Love Too Easily, Time After Time, Let It Snow, Three Coins in the Fountain, and Its Magic. And with Jimmy Van Heusen, he wrote All the Way, Love and Marriage, Call Me Irresponsible, Come Fly With Me, and The Second Time Around. As you may have noticed, many of Cahn's songs were written for Frank Sinatra. Sammy Cahn grew up in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. His parents were Jewish immigrants. Before becoming a songwriter, he played violin at the Catskill Resorts in the Borscht Belt. He dropped out of high school to play in the orchestra of Bowery burlesque houses. During his composing career, he's written material for individual entertainers, for big bands, for the movies, for Broadway. For his movie songs, he's won 4 Academy Awards and at least 33 Oscar nominations. In 1974, he performed on Broadway in a review of his songs titled Words and Music. Since 1975, Sammy Cahn has served as the president of the Songwriters Hall of Fame. He lives in Los Angeles, and he's on the East Coast this week, and we're delighted that he's able to visit with us today. Welcome to Fresh Air.
It's I'm a great very, treat very to pleased have you to be sitting here just to have listened to that rundown of my life. That's very, very, very fascinating. Did I do all that?
That's right, and more. You started writing in, I guess it was the early 1930s. Now, this when you were writing, it was really, I think, the peak of Tin Pan Alley. Did you have a feeling that behind every typewriter in New York and Brooklyn, there was a songwriter competing with you?
Oh, not behind each typewriter, behind each pad of paper, I imagine. When I got my first typewriter, it was very, very, very strong rise in my status. A typewriter? I still have that typewriter. It's in the Songwriters Hall of Fame Museum. That typewriter, the very same typewriter.
Did you have any shticks to get into the door when you were first starting? And you had to get your song presented to someone. The competition must have been great.
No, you must understand if there was a shtick, I had it. But with all the shticks, I couldn't get in the door. And I remember that the last time I tried, Saul Kaplan, as a matter of fact, to be accurate, Saul Kaplan, Lou Levy, and I were waiting outside the office of Mr. Jack Robbins of the Robbins Music Corporation, legendary music publisher. And we had waited weeks and weeks to get this appointment. It was to be at 3 o'clock, and we got there at 1 o'clock to make sure he didn't miss his appointment. And he kept going in and out of his office saying, 3 o'clock, I know you. I'm seeing you at 3 o'clock. And at 2 o'clock, he said, 3 o'clock. At 2:15, he said, 3 o'clock. At 2:30, 3 o'clock. And finally, he said, near 3 o'clock, as we were about to go into the office, Paul Whiteman, the legendary Paul Whiteman, unannounced, entered the offices. And Jack Robbins looked at us as if to say, I can't help this. And we understood that he couldn't help this, and Paul Whiteman took our place. And I walked out of that office really, really crestfallen and really, really dejected. And I looked at my friends and said, I'm never, ever again going into a publisher's office until he sends for me. And started to write special material. And I'm going back with you to early 1930. That's almost 54 years ago. And I started to write material. And the first thing happened, there was a young girl who said, oh, I just bought some marvelous arrangements. And what they did in those days, they took any popular song, and they did what they used to call them Al Siegel arrangements. Al Siegel was a man who was a pianist, and he played for Ethel Merman, as a matter of fact, the legendary Ethel Merman, when she was very young. And he used to make those Ethel Merman-type arrangements. Come get together, let the dance floor feel your rather. Come get together, let's dance, let's up. And I said, she said, I bought three Al Siegel type arrangements. I said, what'd you pay for those? He says, I paid $100 for these three arrangements. I said, I'll do those. I'll do those for $20 a piece. And got into the business of making arrangements for singers.
What was the first song that you were successful with?
Well, I'm coming to that. The first song that the publisher called us for, Lou Levy, he was a Lindy Hop dancer. As a matter of fact, I was telling someone today that Lou Levy, in blackface, I'll say that slowly again, Lou Levy, wearing blackface, did a Lindy Hop dance in Bob Hope's act. And he used to dance in blackface with black bands. Lou Levy. So Lou Levy came to us one day and he said, hey, I ran into Jimmy Lunsford. And Jimmy Lunsford is going up to the Apollo Theater. And he needs an opening song for his orchestra. And I wrote, Rhythm Is Our Business. And just as a piece of material.
Want to give it a listen?
I'd love to.
Okay, why don't we listen to Jimmy Lunsford's recording of Rhythm Is Our Business, which is the first song that Sammy Cahn sold? Was it the first song you sold?
It was the first song that a publisher called us about.
Okay, well, let's hear it.
Rhythm is our business, business show is swell. Now, if you're feeling blue, rhythm's what you need. If you got rhythm, you're sure to succeed. Rhythm is our business, business show is swell. He's a drummer man, on demand.
On demand.
Crawl beats on them drums. In the band.
In the band.
Now, when he does tricks with sticks, the boys in the band all play hot licks. Plays saxophone in the band.
In the band.
Joe plays the saxophone in the band.
In the band.
Now when he goes up that scale, beat it, bop doot that doot daddy. On the bass in the band.
In the band.
Mose plays on the bass in the band.
In the band.
Now when he picks all those strings, happiness you he brings. He plays on the trumpet in the band.
In the band.
Steve blows all that trumpet in the band.
In the band.
Oh, he's a guy, hits him high, makes you think he's in the sky. On rhythm is our business.
This Rhythm Is Our Business, a 1934 recording featuring Jimmy Lunsford and his orchestra, alto saxophonist Willie Smith doubling on vocals, with lyrics by my guest Sammy Cahn. That's a great song.
It's just that established me in a curious sense as a writer for big bands. And I started to get calls from the big bands, and this led me indirectly to Tommy Dorsey. And the Jimmy Lunsford Band was, for me, one of the great, great thrills in the band business, to watch the Jimmy Lunsford Band. It was just incredible. And Cy Oliver was an impeccable, impeccable talent. Cy Oliver is today at the Rainbow Room in New York City.
No kidding.
Really. Marvelous talent. And Cy Oliver migrated to Tommy Dorsey. Tommy Dorsey was one of the most incredible, incredible men of music I ever met. I love Tommy Dorsey. And through Tommy Dorsey, I met the one and the only Mr. Sinatra, Frank and Axel Stordahl, one of the most marvelously talented men. And above all, one of the greatest human beings I ever met was Axel Stordahl.
I know that when you write a song for somebody, I think you usually sing the song for them.
Oh, yes. Before,
what's it like when you sing a song for a Sinatra before he sings it?
He's a very fortunate man. You know, I'm married to a lady called Tita, T-I-T-A. And she always used to say to me, she said, do you sing like Sinatra, or does he sing like you? Or how does that work? I said, well, the song came first, didn't it? No, but you see, I sing the song for the first time. Whatever the song is, I sing it for the first time. And I stand in front of Sinatra, and I am a lethal demonstrator.
What was the hardest song to demonstrate for him? None of them.
None of them. No, no. Look, if I stand in front of you, you're doomed. I'm lethal. I don't know if you understand the true meaning. When I stand in front of you and take my posture, I am ready. I know my part. And if you have any sense of words and music, first of all, I wouldn't stand in front of you to begin with unless I was ready. And I will say to you, we have the song for so-and-so, for instance. And I've enjoyed singing many, many songs for him. Like I will say, we have the song that you sing to the little boy.
High Hopes.
In Hole in the Head. Well, he knows what we mean. One of the most memorable moments of demonstrating songs is when I sang the songs to Our Town. Our Town for the first time. I'll never forget, we came and we sang to him. It was kind of around twilight time. I'll never forget, it was kind of quiet. With no one around, just him sitting in an easy chair. When Sinatra reflects, he rolls the bottom of his thumb over his lower lip. And that's how he reflects. And his highest praise is, yeah, yeah, high praise.
You will like the folks you meet in our town. The folks you meet on any street in our town. Pick out any cottage, white or brown, they're all so appealing with that lived-in feeling. You will like the shady lanes in our town, the music of the passing trains in our town. You will lose your heart, I promise you, in this 2x4 town. Welcome on the door town. If you'll make it your town too.
And he doesn't turn down a song, never has.
Did he ever want to change a lyric that you wrote?
Only one time.
Which one was that?
That's in the song, one of my very, very favorite songs, The Last Dance. We started the idea of writing an opening song for an album and a closing song for an album. Like Come Fly With Me. Opens with Come Fly With Me, of course, and the closing song, which is It's Nice to Go Traveling. So, and then we wrote Come Dance With Me. And then we needed a closing song. And we quickly discovered that Irving Berlin, the legendary Irving Berlin, I'm on the board of directors of ASCAP. And I can tell you that Irving Berlin is the music industry all by himself. And as we're talking now, he is 96 or 97 years old. He's just the most incredible genius. So I discovered that he'd written every song you can possibly write about dancing. Cheek to Cheek, Change Partners, I'm Putting On My Top Hat, Change Partners. So usually I write a song very, very swiftly. But here I am, and I can't come up with the last song. And Frank Sinatra, who's used to me giving him the song swiftly, says, "Where's that last song?" And I keep saying, "The last song. We're looking for the last song." And where's the? And I don't write as haphazardly. I think about it, and when I come up with a title or something, I want it to be a little special. And every time I turn, I'm running into Irving Berlin. Finally, I turned to Van Heusen one day. I said, "Has there ever been a song called The Last Dance?" And Van Heusen, who was very, very familiar with the literature of songs, said, "No. It's been the Save the Last Waltz for me, but not The Last." I said, "Sit down." And I said, "It's The Last Dance. We've come to The Last Dance. They're dimming the lights down. They're hoping we'll go. It's obvious they're aware of us, the pair of us, alone on the floor. But I want to hold you like this forevermore." So Sinatra is recording this song. And I had lines that they're wondering just when will we leave. But till we leave, keep holding me tight through the last dance. Each beat of the last dance, and save me the first dance in your dreams tonight. So it's when you speak, you would say, they're wondering just when we will leave. You wouldn't say, they're wondering just when will we leave. So he said, they're wondering just when we will leave. I said, no, it isn't. If I hold it, I said, it's they're wondering just when will we leave, but till we leave. He said, what kind of cockamamie word is... I said, no one speaks like that. I said, no one speaks like that. But we aren't speaking, Frank, are we? We're singing, aren't we, Frank? And that's the only time we ever kind of good-naturedly quarreled about a line.
It's the last dance with... Come to the last dance. They're dimming the light. down. They're hoping we'll go. It's obvious they're aware of us, the pair of us, alone on the floor. Still, I want to hold you like this forever and more. It's the last song. They're playing the last song. The orchestra's yawning. I know they're wondering just when will we leave, but till we leave, keep holding me tight through the last dance, each beat of the last dance. And save me the first dance in your dreams tonight.
You know the song you wrote All the Way? Of course, you know the song you wrote All the Way that he had quite a big hit with. Did you ever have in the back of your mind the expression "going all the way"?
No, never.
I always wondered about that.
That song.
How did you get that hook?
I'll tell you. That song was written, actually, to cover many dramatic points. First of all, the film was written. The song was written for a film called "The Joker Is Wild," and I said to Jimmy Van Heusen, I said, "They can't possibly want to call this film 'The Joker Is Wild.' Sounds like a card game picture, Las Vegas gambling picture, needs, The Joker Is Wild. No, so we better think of a good title." And for days we kicked some titles on the fly, so I got the title. Frank Sinatra, All the Way. He loves All the Way. He acts All the Way. You know, he gets the women all, you know, it's an all-encompassing title, All the Way. And then we came up with the melody, which had a dramatic notion to it. In the picture, you know, he loses his voice. So when you hear him singing the first time, he sings, "When somebody loves you, it's no good unless he loves you." Big notes. All the way. You hear him singing that large and loud. Now, when he tries to come back after his throat has been cut, in a sense, he starts to sing, "When somebody loves you," these are even notes, "it's no good unless you love you." And he takes a breath, and you see on his face, he's not going to be able to hit all the way those notes again. That's when he goes as Joe Louis, the comic, into comedy. That was all the idea. So you know what they call the film? The Joker Is Wild.
How did you feel when Love and Marriage, which Sinatra also sang, became a... with different lyrics, a Campbell's soup ad with soup and sandwich.
That was done. Most of my songs today, you know what it is now.
What?
We're on PBS, aren't we? So we don't do commercials, but we can talk about them. Right now, it's on for Ban Roland. No, but you know, I tell you something. Here's what I feel about it. Anyone that pays you money to use your melody, I think is being very, very flattering. I think anyone who gives you a lot of money is being very flattering. And then you know my song, which goes back to the year 1937 by Mayor Mr. Shane. Well, they used it for a big root beer commercial. Root beer or Mr. Shane? You know about Come Fly With Me, been used for ever so many airplane
just what
people.
Makes that
High Hopes. The song High Hopes, High C, I drank High C. So I think it's very, very flattering.
Move a rubber tree.
It's very, very flattering.
He's got high hopes. He's got high hopes. He's got high apple pie in the sky. So anytime you're getting low, instead of letting go, just remember that ant. Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
Let's talk about some of the tools of the trade. You've written a rhyming dictionary. Did you actually use one? Did you ever use one when
I
you
always
writing?
Had a rhyming dictionary.
Yeah?
For the composer. That's the truth.
Really?
I always felt that if I couldn't think of the word, I shouldn't use it. But the composer used to say to me, every time I was writing, the composer used to say to me, you have a rhyming dictionary? I said, sure, here it is. Give it to the composer.
Right, I get. Are there words that you really avoid because you know they're unrhymable?
No, in my rhyming dictionary, do you have it?
No, I don't. I wish I did.
I will get you one. Every word is rhymable. Rhymable, rhymable. Take a simple name that. Name like Nicholas. You can rhyme it with ridiculous if you aren't too meticulous. You know, every word's rhymable.
Is there a song that you've written that you're proudest of the rhymes you were able to come up with?
Yes, the one I tell everyone, the one I'm very, very proud of is Call Me Irresponsible. Simply because I am wont to say, and it's not as facetious as it sounds, is that it has five syllable words in it. Call me unpredictable. Tell me I'm impractical. I said, five-syllable words from a fellow who came from a one-syllable neighborhood.
You know what I love in that song? Throw in undependable, too. I love the throw in. How did you get that?
It's
so vernacular.
Every song, as I say in the rhyming dictionary, every song, the title dictates the architecture of the song. If you say the title is Call Me Irresponsible, da 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 da, that's the architecture. Now, that song starts off, Call Me Irresponsible, Call Me Undependable, Throw in Unreliable too. Do my foolish alibis bore you? Well, I'm not too clever, I just adore you. Call me unpredictable, tell me I'm impractical. Rainbows I'm inclined to pursue. Call me irresponsible. Yes, I'm undependable, but it's undeniably true. I said, you know, Jim, if I had unreliable down there, undeniable coming after unreliable would be better. So we switched the two lines on top. I call that neatening up a song. So we changed the two lines on top, so I would have, call me irresponsible, yes, I'm unreliable, but it's undeniably true.
Call me irresponsible, call me unreliable, throw in undependable too. Do my foolish alibis bore you? Well, I'm not too clever, I just adore you. Call me unpredictable, tell me I'm impractical. Rainbows I'm inclined to pursue. Call me irresponsible. Yes, I'm unreliable, but it's undeniably true that I'm irresponsibly mad for you. Go on and call me unpredictable. Tell me that I'm impractical. Rainbows I'm inclined to pursue. You go ahead and call me irresponsible. I admit I'm unreliable, but it is undeniably true.
Are there any songs that you ever ran into a complete mental block about? You'd gotten halfway through it. It was terrific, no, and you just couldn't.
If a song fights me, I don't write it.
Really?
I write at a typewriter, an IBM typewriter, a special IBM typewriter that has an especially larger uppercase letter, and my lyrics stand off the page. And all the people who know me know that typewriter, know my lyric, and they're accustomed to this lyrics.
What's the favorite verse that you've written? Because, you know, very few people know the verses to even very popular songs, and sometimes I figure composers and lyricists must feel that they're writing it in vain because so few performers deal with it.
When so much time was given to a record, and the records got onto jukeboxes. And so every time the record was too long, it didn't earn enough money quickly, so they stopped writing verses. But one of my very favorite verses was to a song called You're My Girl from the show High Button Shoes, where the boy says, the kids that see me come to call have written your name and my name on the wall. It's common gossip everywhere that you and I have got it bad for fair. You're my girl. I've chosen you to be mine my whole life through. I like that verse.
That is nice.
And there's a lovely verse which I wish I can remember a word of right now. The verse it's been a long, long time. It has a very nice verse. All the war songs had some nice verses.
You've spent a lot of time on contract to different movie companies in the 40s,
in those years, yeah.
Now, that would really put you on the spot, because if you had to write a title song for a movie, no matter how weird the title was, you'd have to get the title?
Yeah. Oh, I got the weird titles.
What were some of the weirdest ones?
The weirdest one I thought was when Jimmy Van Heusen and I were driving out to Universal Picture Studios, and I said to Jimmy Van Heusen, they possibly cannot want us to write a song called Thoroughly Modern Millie. Sing it, you can't even speak it. Thoroughly Modern Millie? So I thought they were calling to have us come up with a title song. And we got out there, and what's his name? I'll think of it in a minute. The producer said, isn't that the catchiest title you ever heard? Thoroughly Modern Millie. And I thought to myself, oh, we're doomed. And I normally will use a title over and over in a lyric. You know, the title Thoroughly Modern Millie doesn't appear once, but once in that song?
When the last line?
The last line. Everything today is thoroughly modern. Check your personality. Everything today makes yesterday slow. Better face reality. It's not insanity, says Vanity Fair. In fact, it's proper to raise your skirt and bob your hair. Have you seen the way they kiss in the movies? Isn't it delectable? Painting lips and pencil lining your brow. Now it's quite respectable. Goodbye, good goody girl. I'm changing in how. So beat the drums, cause here comes Thoroughly Modern Millie now.
Everything. Everything today is thoroughly modern. Bands are getting jazzier. Everything today is starting to go. Cars are getting snazzier. Men say it's criminal what women'll do. What they're forgetting is this is 1922. Have you seen the way they kiss in the movies? Isn't it delectable? Painting lips and pencil lining your brow. Now it's quite respectable. Goodbye, good goody girl. I'm changing and how. So beat the drums, cause here comes thoroughly modern lady now.
Must have been really something working with so many dinosaur egos in the movie industry. Because between the actors and the directors and the movie owners.
Well, we never had anything to do with the actors.
You didn't?
No.
Didn't you sell them your songs, though, after you wrote it?
No.
Really?
No,
in the movies you couldn't
them,
do that?
No. We usually wrote the score for the producer. And then they hired all the actors and the singers. Well, we usually know, the score to Romance on the High Seas, which introduced Doris Day. Also, I must tell you a marvelous anecdote. I went to dinner the other night at the home of Mark Goodson, you know, the famous game show man. I'm sitting across the table from this very, very attractive Oriental lady. And she says, "Oh, we have the same name." I said, but we don't spell the same. I said, "I'm Cahn, C-A-H-N, you're probably Cahn, K-H-A-N, to this Oriental lady." She says, "No, Cahn." "Well, how do you spell it?" She says, "K-A-N." "Oh, well, I'm Sammy Cahn, C-A-H-N. What is your first name?" She says, "Yusai Cahn." "Yusai Cahn, how do you spell that?" She says, "U-Y-U-E. Sai, S-A-I-K-A-N, Yusai Cahn." "That's a lovely name." She says, "I want to thank you for dedicating that song to me." I said, "What song?" She says, "Yusai, the song begins." It's a true story. I got the copy of It's Magic, and I took the white out, and I changed the words for her.
Would you ever turn down a movie title because a movie theme because you thought that the title was so ridiculous?
I wrote The Tender Trap.
Is that for a movie?
Yes. And Jack Benny, the late Jack Benny, used to see me. "How could you write a song called The Tender Trap?" I said, "Well, I heard the word trap and I thought of the word snap, and the song was written." That's not really. Trap and Snap, is that the song?
You wrote the song. This was also for a movie, wasn't it, Be My Love?
Oh, yes.
Okay, now how did you sell that song to Mario Lanza? This Be My Love, that love is a really high note. Lanza's known for his range.
No, we must explain something to you. The melody, now which comes first, the words or the music? The phone call. That comes first. In this instance, the music was already written in ink. Love theme for Lanza. Dee-da-dee, dee-dee-da-da-da. Every note was written, not in pencil, which you can erase and make a change. Written in ink. Love theme for Lanza. By this very, very talented little Hungarian, Nicholas Brodsky, friend of Joseph Pasternak, another little Hungarian. And I was called in to put a lyric to this melody. Now, I'm very, very, very proud of that lyric. Because you listen to that lyric again, I tell people that I don't write a lyric as much as the lyric writes me. I happen to be in the room while it's happening, so I'm very fortunate to be able to claim the royalties, if you know what I mean. But think about it. The title is Be My Love. They're absolutely singing words. Be my love. You can sing every one of those. For no one else can end this yearning. this need that you and you alone create. You can, every one of those words, you can bite them and chew them. Now, I don't know if you realize that when I wrote that lyric, not a word rhymes.
Gosh, you're right. I hadn't realized that before.
Just fill my arms the way you fill my dreams. No rhymes yet. We're halfway through a song. First rhyme. The dreams that you inspire with every sweet desire. And I'm not rolling my R's the way opera people love to do. Now I rhyme the whole song. Be my love, and with your kisses set me burning, yearning, burning. One kiss is all I need to seal my fate, create fate. I rhyme the song in the after song. Yeah. Now, listen how every word fits the mouth and really singing words. And a hand in a hand, we'll find love's promised land. There'll be no one but you. Ooh, ooh sound is very good on the high notes. For me, eternal. Now, Lanza, who had a voice that you could not believe unless you heard it in person, no mechanical reproduction of this voice does it any justice. In a room with him, it was a staggering experience. So, there'll be no one but you for me. Eternally, he added that. Eternally, if you will be my love.
Be my love, for no one else can end this yearning, this need that you and you alone create. Just fill my arms the way you filled my dreams, the dreams that you inspire with every sweet desire. Be my love, and with your kisses set me burning. One kiss is all I need to seal my fate, and hand in hand we'll find love's promised land. There'll be no one but you for me. Eternally, if you will be mine.
I say to you, he knew every note of that song. He didn't know the lyric. I had the lyric. And you know what chutzpah is. You know what chutzpah means? That's cheek or gall. Chutzpah, the classic version is, the ancient version is, this chap kills his parents and he pleads for mercy because he's an orphan. That's classic chutzpah. But modern chutzpah is me singing to Mario Lanza. Well, that's some chutzpah of some kind. So Mario looked at me after I talk sang Be My Love for the first time. He took the lyric out of my hand as contemptuously as you can take a lyric out of someone's hand. And he sang Be My Love back at me. And I tell you, that was an experience. That really, really was an experience. I've had many, many really exciting experiences. You know, one of the great, great joys of writing songs is the moment of truth. You know, the first moment of truth is when you sing the song for the first time to the prospective producer, the singer. That's the moment of truth. You know, you sing your songs that you write for your friends. I know they're happy. Oh, that's great. But that's all nonsense. The man who pays you to write the song in the hard world of business, that moment of truth is the moment of truth. And I've had many. The song Call Me Irresponsible was written for Fred Astaire.
Well, he's one of my favorite singers, by the way.
That was a goal that I thought I'd never achieve in my life. Standing in front of Fred Astaire. Call Me Irresponsible was written for Fred Astaire. And the day came when I stood in front of him. It's one of the few great, great thrills of my life. And I've had more than a few. Standing in front of him when I sang, call me irresponsible, call me unreliable, throw in undependable too. Do my foolish alibis bore you? Well, I'm not too clever, I just adore you. He said, stop. Jimmy Van Heusen almost fell off the piano bench. And he said, that's one of the best songs I've ever heard. And I said, that's one of the best half songs you've ever heard. Do you mind if I finish?
That's chutzpah too, isn't
it? No. No, that was an experience, a rare experience. And when I finished the song, he said to me, would you like to know how you got this assignment? I said, yes, I would like to know. He says, you got this assignment because Johnny Mercer wasn't available.
Ouch.
And I said, no, I said, I consider that a high, high compliment. He said, no, I will give you the compliment. The next time Johnny Mercer leaves town, I won't be worried at all. And that was a very rare experience for me with Fred Astaire. So I've had some really, really incredible experiences with songs and demonstrating. Singing to Bing Crosby for the first time was a rare experience.
What did you sing to him?
Oh, I was just singing some songs and some of the songs I'd written. And I really leaned in. I leaned in a little bit, if you know what I mean. And he looked up at me and said, you're pretty good. I said, pretty good? I'm the best. He said, what about Mac Gordon? I said, Mac Gordon is disqualified. He sings. And he did.
Do you think of your songs as having any Yiddish influence in it or Yiddish inflection in the lyrics?
I doubt it. What my songs have is a naturalness. You can call that anything you want, but I would not write a line that wouldn't be. If you pick up a song of mine, A, it will not stay in your mouth. It'll sing easily. Kiss me once and kiss me twice and kiss me once again. It's been a long... It'll flow out of your voice. It's almost like you'll be singing almost without wanting to. And then someone once thought they were, what's the word, putting me down, but paid me one of my rare compliments. The trouble with Sammy Cahn, he writes the way people talk.
Kiss me once, kiss me twice, kiss me once again.
It's been a long...
How long?
A long, long time.
Haven't felt like this, my dear, since can't remember when.
It's been a long...
Long.
Oh, such a long time.
You'll never know how many dreams I've dreamed about you.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, just how empty they all seemed without you.
Kiss me once.
Okay.
Kiss me twice.
Okay.
Kiss me once again. It's been a long, long time.
Should you write until the real thing comes along?
That's very, very simple. I was then around the Decca Record Company. There was a band called Andy Kirk and his Clouds of Joy. I was called in by Mr. Jack Capp, one of the fathers of the album. He said, there's a band here's got a melody. Listen to it. That's the story of that song.
And you just wrote the lyric? How'd you get the hook?
Hey, it was there. Actually, when I hear music, it's music speaks to me. I'll never forget, I walked into a room. I had just written I've Heard That Song Before with Julie Stein. I was on clouds. I was so happy. Just coming out of the doldrums, and I walked into a room, and there were Axel Stordahl and Paul Weston. And I said, look at him. Look at him. He writes a song in half hour, and it takes us 2 days to make it sound like something. There were arrangers, and always grousing. I said, why don't you fellows write a song? They said, we've written a song. I said, let me hear it. They said, wait till we finish this arrangement. And they were arranging my song. I've heard that song before, for Tommy Dorsey. They said to me, what kind of an introduction do you want? I said, what do I care about the introduction? Who walks down the street humming an introduction? I said, for all I care, you can give me one note. And the Tommy Dorsey arrangement of I've Heard That Song Before had one note. It wanted just... Dee da 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 da. One up. Those were carefree, marvelous days. Now they finish this arrangement. They go to the piano. Both these gentlemen. Axel Stordahl on the left hand, and Paul Weston on the right hand, and they play. Dee da 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 da. Da da dee da 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 da. I knew instantly. Don't ask me how or why. I would call that I Should Care. And I couldn't wait for them to finish. I finished. I said, what do you call that? They said, we don't call it anything. I said, you don't have any words? They said, no. I just start at the top. And that's how I write. I said, I should care. I should go around weeping. I should care. I should go without sleeping. Now, the moment you accept I should care, I should go around weeping, the song is written. You follow. I mean that seriously. Once you accept I should care, I should go around weeping. I should care. I should go without peeping, leaping, creeping. It can only be without sleeping. Strangely enough, I sleep well. Sure, there's a dream or two, but then I count my sheep well. Funny how sheep can lull you to sleep, so I should care.
I should care. I should go around with
not sleeping. Strangely enough, I sleep well, except for a dream or two. But then I count my sheep well. Funny how sheep can lull you to sleep so. Doesn't get me. Maybe I won't find someone as lovely as you, but I should care, and I do.
Yourself as having a theme song of all the songs you've written, the one that's really you, or the one that you would want played when you walked into a room?
No, I really don't.
Hmm?
No, I know.
You've worked with a lot of great composers, but the people who you've had the longest relationships with in collaboration with Julie Stein
and Jimmy Van Heusen.
Mm-hmm. Different. I've always figured that collaboration between a songwriter and a lyricist is probably a lot like a marriage, where you fall in and out of love, so to speak, and sometimes things are working.
You mean with collaborators?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I think I tell people two men working on a song is a love affair, and each song is a child.
Would you get into a little different, almost like neurotic relationships when things weren't working and you had to get the song?
When you're writing a song, there's only one way. It has to be absolutely compatible. You can't. Oh, it has to be compatible. Well, you know, when you walk in a room to write a song, all that nonsense is left at the door. All that nonsense is left at the door. The writing has to be... I never didn't have a good time writing a song. Absolutely. It's the most fun I have. I say I should never let anybody watch me write a song. I'd never get paid.
Well, I really love your songs. Well, your songs have certainly endured and will continue to, I'm sure. And we're out of
as
time.
As long as I'm around.
That's right. I want to thank you a lot for
visiting. I want to thank you. I like
us.
The way you listen.
Thanks very much for being here.
I want to thank you. I want to thank this wonderful station. And why do you call it Why?
Oh, WHYY? Oh, okay. Well, thanks a lot.
I want to thank you, and every time I'm in town, I promise you, I'm going to call you and I'm going to ask you, can I come by and talk?
Well, that would be great. If we could do another show, that would be
great. I promise you. I threaten you.
Okay. My guest has been lyricist Sammy Cahn.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Man, it doesn't show signs of stopping, and I've brought me some corn for popping. The lights are turned way down low, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, how I'll hate going out in the storm. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. And the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. But as long as you'd love me so, let it snow and snow. Thank you.
finally kiss goodnight, how I'll hate going out in the storm. But if you really grab me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. Oh, the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. But as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
This is Fresh Air. I'm Terry Gross.